Hello and welcome to Tremors, Making Perfection, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Gross, and every Friday for the next 6 weeks, we're going deep on the making of Tremors with the people who made it. From the very first draft of the script that birthed the Graboids, to the challenges of filming in the middle of the desert, the cast and crew are going to tell you everything you need to know about the monster movie that became a cult classic. So graboid yourself a seat, and let's make perfection. When Kevin Bacon joined the cast of Tremors to play young Val, he was in a tough place. His wife was about to give birth to their first child, and he was out of work. Tremors seemed like a risky move, but the right choice for his young family. So with a phone on standby on the set to notify him if his wife went into labor, he saddled up to go catch some graboids. There was little time to shoot everything and a lot for Kevin to do as the garbage man turned graboid hunter. Here's Kevin Bacon on his experience on set.
We're going to talk about the origins of Tremors and the making of Tremors. How were you convinced to be in Tremors in the first place?
You know, I don't really remember the specifics of getting convinced, but I could tell you, but to be brutally honest, I was running out of money. And I was feeling like at a real kind of low point career-wise. You know, I suffer from the actor's curse, which is that I always think that every single job I do is my last. And, you know, after Footloose came out, I had a series of leading roles that just all bombed, just kind of one after another, after another, after another. And I felt that, you know, my career was really like close to ending. And my wife was pregnant with our first child. And my mother had also been diagnosed with cancer. And I was kind of at a terrified sort of like point in my life, both, you know, in my personal life and in my career-wise. And I saw the bank account dwindling and was feeling a lot of, you know, financial and kind of personal pressure. So when my agent called me up and said, there's this movie, I don't know if you're going to like it. You know, it's kind of a horror movie, but it's sort of funny and, you know, and it's like, it's about giant worms underground. I was like, oh my God, my career is in the toilet. Like if this is what it's come to, this is like the, you know, the bottom of the barrel. I read the script and I said, you know, I don't know that this is going to work, but I know that I can have fun with the part. And I know that the writing is strong and that the relationship between these two guys, if you take all of the, you know, the silliness of the graboids out of it, you know what I mean? I said, I think the relationship between the two guys is funny and interesting. And I really responded to the fact that, you know, people don't often write, usually if you write the lead, like a lead guy, you know, he's either like super smart or he's super street smart or he's like a real badass or he's got superpowers or something. What I really liked was that, you know, Val is, he's just not that smart a guy necessarily. And he's not successful and he doesn't have superpowers and he's not really that much of a badass either. There's an innocence about him too. And so I really responded to that. And, you know, kind of, it was a, so signing on was a sort of a combination of really, really needing to work and really feeling like I needed to work. And also seeing that there was possibly something that I could do with this guy.
When Tremors was initially released, it wasn't exactly a big hit.
We have to think about the time. I mean, I'll say a couple of things about the release of the film. funny scary is a very, very difficult thing to market. It always has been. The amount of, there are exceptions to the rule. And when those exceptions happen, they really are an anomaly. I like it as a genre myself. I love things like Shaun of the Dead and Zombieland. There's a lot of cool movies that live within that in that world. But it's a lot easier from a marketing standpoint to tell people, this is a scary movie or this is a funny movie, because then they know what they're doing on their weekend. And they know they can talk to their date and say, do you like scary? And, you know, whatever, you know. So, the marketing materials and the way in for Tremors was a little confusing. I don't even remember, you know, the original poster, I guess when you look at it now, it seems like it was really cool, but I don't know if it quite told the story about the fact that the movie had a sort of tongue-in-cheek kind of attitude to it. I think they leaned a little bit more into it was just a monster movie. And so for whatever reason, people really didn't go. I remember going to the premiere. I think the premiere was in Westwood. And, you know, you can just feel that studio's not really behind it. That it's probably not going to get any kind of love from the critics. And the chances are, you know, from my standpoint, I was like, yep, here we go. I'm in another bomb.
Why do you feel Tremors has become the cult classic that it is today?
At the time, the video rental business was really exploding. Blockbuster was the biggest thing going. Everybody was going to the video store to rent a movie and come home, and there were stacks of titles that didn't have theatrical releases. Now, in my mind, direct-to-video was like the last thing you want it to be. Somehow, it kind of caught on in that world, and you know, you'd go to the video store, and they'd have ordered, you know, 10 copies of it. That was always a barometer on how popular things were, because, you know, literally the owner of the video store would get a certain amount of copies and they'd rent them and bring them back and the whole thing. It didn't really do much for me in terms of my career, because it's not like I was trying to have a video rental business. That was not what my, you know, that's not where I wanted to kind of live. But I think there was a cumulative sort of effect of the popularity of that movie, to the point where at this point, most people don't realize that it wasn't a successful movie. You know, like most people that I talk to, if I tell them that, they go, Tremors? No, Tremors is not. Tremors is a classic. You know, and there's not a lot of movies that have really done that, I don't think. You know, it's a handful, but not that many.
Can you talk about your relationship with Fred Ward during the making of Tremors?
Yeah. Fred Ward he was an actor who I already knew, not personally, but I knew his work. And I thought he was a really great, interesting choice, because Fred has a real genuine sort of American cowboy, you know, man of the earth kind of persona. And you could have gone and said, well, let's see who's kind of like a funny guy that we can put in this part, you know, but they really didn't cast in that way. You know what I mean? They really wanted some authenticity in that role. And I thought he really lended a lot of authenticity to it. And I think that we immediately kind of bonded and made friends and started hanging out together and started talking a lot about music. He was really obsessed with jazz guitar at the time. And I played a little bit of guitar and ended up playing a lot more over the course of you know, the years following Tremors. But yeah, I was playing and writing songs, and he was like crazy about Django Reinhardt, and was his whole approach to the guitar was not really to learn guitar. It was like to it was like to learn to play some of the most complicated jazz chord structures and melodies, which is a really kind of like Renaissance man strange approach to an instrument. You know, me, I picked up the guitar so I could play Hey Jude, you know, and it was as though you were it's the difference between starting to like just do watercolors or saying, well, I want to work on like duplicating the Sistine Chapel. You know, it's, he has a very, very interesting approach to that, and very, very focused person and performer. And he's just such an unusual character that I really sparked to him. And, you know, we enjoyed our time in the desert together.
Do you think there's something about the location, Lone Pine, in Northern California that adds something to the film?
Well, I had never been to Lone Pine, California before we did the film. And, you know, I kind of had assumed that we would be shooting in L.A. because there are places within a stone's throw of L.A. that you can, you know, create a small, dusty, you know, you could have done this. There's a lot of places I've seen them since then, you know, different ranches and stuff where you could have definitely created this. But the filmmakers really wanted to go to Lone Pine. And I was concerned about it on a really practical level, which was that Kira was so pregnant, and she could have had gone into labor during the shooting, and it was hours to get to any kind of a hospital. There were, we had some kind of like birth, you know, doulas like standing by, and she was going down, driving down to LA to the for her weekly you know, appointments with the obstetrician. But that was a little terrifying to me, that she was going to go into labor in Lone Pine. And simultaneously, we also had this thing where we really wanted to be together for this time, and you know, this was a magical kind of special time for us. But we got there, and we had this, you know, there was very few places to stay. You know, it didn't really have the infrastructure even to put the crew up, and certainly nothing that was like a high end kind of thing. So down this little street, somebody was willing to move out of their house. I guess this is long before, you know, Airbnb, and we lived in this little house, and we used to, I remember just going, and we ate a lot of frozen pizza and lasagna, and I would go out, you know, the majority of almost the whole movie is exterior day, which is another thing that's unusual for a horror movie, and a tough thing to pull off, by the way, to make things scary when it's exterior day. And it was hot and it was dusty, and I'd go off in the morning you know, to the wars basically, and you know, drive down this long dirt road. By the time we get to work, and out in the middle of the desert was this town that had, you know, been created, and we would just kind of burn through the day, and when we started to lose the light, go back, and my very pregnant wife would be there, and you know, we'd have some kind of dinner, and I don't know that, maybe it was the place in terms of feeling ominous. I know that for myself, I was having very, very intense dreams and night terrors, and I was doing a lot of sleepwalking. In fact, I more than once picked her up out of bed and carried her out of the house, and to try to save her from monsters or whatever. But it was really metaphorical for what I was feeling about my life changing with, you know, fatherhood, et cetera. And And sometimes on the weekends, we would drive up into the hills, and there's these very, very beautiful, strange kind of rock formations that are in and around Lone Pine that, that I guess traditionally they had shot quite a few old Westerns on. You know, you, when you picture the guy coming over the thing, getting shot, falling off of a, you know, a big rock down into something that was, and we use some of them in the movie, obviously. So, you know, I'm not a real spiritual person, but I would definitely say that it had a tingly sort of magical essence, that town. Also, you know, there's something about the movies that are made on location, which are a little different than when everybody goes home to your individual houses. It's a lot different when we're all kind of thrown into a small situation where there's basically a Double L, which was a, you know, bar, and there was a pizza joint. You'd be out with masks, and it was hot for sure. And this is probably before we'd you know, got either technologically or even you know, medically hip to the importance of you know, sunblock, and you know, it was, we used it, but it was probably not something that was we wouldn't pound the table the way we would now.
Why do you think the film holds up today?
Well, one thing I'll say about the film, I don't go back and look at my movies, but I did with Tremors probably 4 or 5 years ago, because I was developing it as a series. And it's an absolutely beautiful movie, shot in 35 millimeter. And it's kind of spectacular to look at. You forget what watching things on video, the transfers onto video, as opposed to now looking at the digital transfer of what it was. It's just really, really well shot and really well directed. I think Ron did an amazing job. I guess it's really, the essence of it is ordinary people dealing with extraordinary circumstances. It's an antidote to superheroes. You know, it's kind of the opposite of that idea. Nothing against superhero movies. I don't want to get in trouble like Scorsese. But when everyone has, you know, the power to, whatever it is, destroy the world, or, you know, you see that again and again and again. And after a while, it gets kind of hard to relate to after a while. You know, we're looking for the humanity out of superheroes. Whereas something like Tremors, they're all just regular people. You know, Melvin, you know, he's just an annoying kid, you know. Bert Gummer, you know, and everybody knows somebody, you know, your uncle or whatever, that comes to Thanksgiving and says, we need to build a bunker, and, you know, they're coming for our jobs or whatever it is. You know what I mean? He kind of like represents that person. And then, you know, Val and Earl, they're just kind of schlubby guys. And so I think that, to me, that's really the essence, is just regular Joes, you know, trying to fight big worms.
Do you think its success is because that it's not too scary?
I think it's true that it is a good family movie, and I think that's part of why, that may be part of why it didn't work in the theater, and part of why it really worked on Blockbuster, on video, at home. I think I say the F word, but aside from that, there's no nudity. The violence is nowhere near what a lot of, you know, big scary movies have, violence-wise. You know, it's you're not seeing people tortured or you know, co-eds being slashed, you know, the threat is a created, you know, creature. But it does have enough scariness that if you're, you know, what, I don't even know the age, but 10 years old, you know, it's going to be something where you're going to go, ah, dad, your mom, you know, I want to, you know. So I do think that there's a lot to be said for the fact that it kind of has a family vibe. I can also tell you that there's something about it that speaks to the heartland of America. And I don't really quite know what that is, but it does. And the reason I feel that and sense that is because people mention movies of mine to me, you know, all the time. And you start to see in different parts of the world or different countries or different parts of America, rural or whatever, that people responded more to one movie of mine or another. And Tremors comes from the heartland of the USA.
Stay on those residual boulders! And Tammy Lynn Baxter. Too much pole vaulting.
Do you still pole vault?
I've never been on a pole vault since the movie. I seem to remember, though, that I could be wrong about this. This would be a Ron Underwood or Steve question, but it seems like we might have actually had some pole vaulting training. Like someone came out and actually gave us some tips. I could be wrong about that. That's not something you just go and do, you know.
As an actor, which do you prefer doing, green screen or practical and real effects?
Well, green screen is never fun for an actor. You know, to act with a tennis ball or something that's green. Although we're doing sort of less and less of it as the technology has started to, you know, get even easier and more developed. On the other hand, I can tell you that there were times when I would look at how the guys were delivering the effects, which was a lot of times basically puppetry, and I'd go, whoa, I don't know if this is going to work. There's something like really infectious and cool about what they did. Just feels more personal, you know. I think it's a good movie for young people to look at and say, you know, this was all just, nothing was done, you know, in post, or very little, you know. One of my favorite gags was when the you see the wave of the monster through the desert, and they basically built a trench and had a ball and covered it with dirt and then dragged the ball, you know, just down the trench with the dirt. So you just saw that thing. You would never do that now. You'd go, you know, done. But, you know, the ingenuity that they had in order to do that. And I remember just, you know, them talking about that, just buckets of that goo, you know, being on the set and talking about how to, you know, make more goo and what color it was going to be, and, you know, the choice of that sort of like orange kind of vibe that wasn't quite blood, but it was like, you know, it was all very, very well done. I thought really, really well thought out.
What do you think modern sci-fi or monster movies can learn from Tremors?
One thing that's good about Tremors is even though the monster is it never really gets too much of a personality, you know what I mean? It never speaks. It never morphs into a face where you actually see it. You know what I mean? It doesn't have as much personality as, say, dragons, and yet it remains a threat. And it remains scary. And I think that the reason that that works is because the characters are well enough drawn that their reaction to it is kind of embodying this threat. Because when you really look at it, you know, it's kind of scary, but it's really about the fact that these people are just, you know, so terrified of it. And the isolation, I think, that they feel. That's something that's, you know, been used in horror a lot, whether you're on a spaceship and you can't get anywhere, or, you know, you're wherever it happens to be, but locked in a house, you know. I also think, as I mentioned before, that if you want a real challenge, make something scary that's outside during the day, because most scary movies are inside at night, and so exterior day is a real challenge.
What do you think ultimately made Tremors so successful?
I think it's just really, really well written. You know, I think the writing, the dialogue, the characters are well drawn, and you know, the comedy that's there is very, very character based. It's not joke based. It's not really like set up joke. There's nothing that anybody says that is necessarily comedy writing, really. It's just that who these two guys are, what their relationship are, is, you know, the fact that you know, Bert is living in this bunker and has this insane arsenal, you know. I mean, the arsenal, the sight gag of the arsenal itself is funny, and with the when he comes out with these, whatever they are, giant, I don't know, elephant guns or bazookas or whatever it is, you know, that in and of itself is funny. You don't need to have a joke kind of written to make that work. I think it's just a really, really well written script and a really well constructed world.
What do you remember about working with Michael Gross?
Well, like most people, I knew Michael Gross from Family Ties, and that was an incredibly successful show and funny, great, amazing, and he was great on it. And it was really an interesting kind of casting choice and a flip, because he was really known as being this, you know, kind of super liberal, you know, dad kind of part, you know. You could have gone a completely different way with Burt Gummer. It could have been a flat top wearing, you know, kind of more marine, you know, it could be somebody, I can't even think of somebody. I don't know what the casting process was, but there were a lot of, I think the casting Michael was a little bit against type, and he completely embraced it. And then I felt like, you know, Reba, having never acted before, I'm guessing that you know, he was kind of helpful in terms of that, and the two of them had this, I really believe them as husband and wife, and they had this kind of like good sort of working marriage. You know, there was a kind of symbiosis to the way that marriage was working, and I thought it was in its own way, was, you know, very touching, I thought.
You always stated that you never want to revisit any of the characters that you've played, apart from Val in Tremors. Why is that?
You know, I've played a lot of characters, and when I look at that guy, I think to myself, where would he end up in 30 years, you know? I like to think that was his moment of glory, and that you would sort of try to relive it again and again and again. But the question is, if you don't have worms underground, then what are you really left with? You know, I don't normally think that way about, you know, when I finish a character, I really kind of, you know, tend to put them to bed. But that guy, for some reason, has, I don't know, just kind of stayed in my mind. you know, it's interesting because when you talk about how people end up, me going back and kissing the Rhonda character was a reshoot. I don't know if anyone's ever mentioned that. In the original movie, she just left, and I guess, and me and Earl just kind of drove off in the desert. And I think they tested it, and people were disappointed about that because they felt that they wanted him to be have some kind of change, and that. So basically, we went back, and in maybe one day of shooting, luckily I still had my long hair. I went back and kissed her. And if you look at it really carefully, you can see where the reshoot kind of begins. And obviously that was didn't turn it into a box office hit, but I think that it was probably a good idea ultimately.
And you improvised the hammer scene.
It was improv. Yeah, definitely.
Can you talk a bit about that scene?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it kind of speaks to, it speaks to Val's, you know, character that he's not even really good at that, you know? Like, he doesn't really even know how to use a hammer. And that's something he's a handyman. You know what I mean? That's something he definitely should know how to do.
I mean, if we were real serious about money, we'd quit being hired hands.
Handyman, Earl. We are handymen.
Yeah, yeah. We should quit this job and find ourselves some real employment.
Yeah, I can put a bookcase together. I can. I draw the line at electric and plumbing. And sometimes I feel like I think I'm probably in the middle, you know. I'll call the guy if I need to. You know, I don't build shelves. I certainly am better with a hammer than I was in the movie.
That was the legendary Kevin Bacon talking Tremors. Next week, we've got a special bonus episode. So meet back here next Friday, sharp. In the meantime, if you want to brush up on your survival skills in the event of a graboid invasion, head over to the official Tremors YouTube and Facebook channel, or find us on Twitter and Instagram @TremorsMovie. Over and out.